What's up, guys? Welcome to the American Campfire Revival, night 55 of our 100-day plan. And I'm so happy that you could join me because things are about to get lit. And I mean that both campfire-wise and revival-wise. So, lately we've been talking about how we can make the world a better place. How after this post-Civil War of our flesh, during a reconstruction period, how we should look to God and rely on God in order to guide us in our steps. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to pray real fast, and we'll dive right in to what is going to be said today. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for just allowing us to gather together, Lord, and I pray that this will be a time of worship to you, and that you would open up the hearts and the minds of those listening, Lord, and that you would speak through me so that those listening and I would both be able to soak and understand what you have to say, Lord, that it would not be my words, but yours. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to come together, and I pray for everyone watching, and that you would just give them guidance, Lord, and give me guidance. And in your holy name, amen. Psalms 32:8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. Isn't it great that we are human? And because we're human, we can't see the full path that lies ahead. But isn't it great that God can? He not only sees the path, he created the path. It is simply just up to us to take a step of faith to continue walking on that path and to just keep moving forward. It does take faith, and that faith can only come from a reliance on God. We've been talking about how we can make the world a better place, and the first way that I identified that we can do that is by having a reliance on God. I explained why in that video, but in short, the reason why we need to have a reliance on God is because without him, we can do nothing else. And I mean nothing else. We can leave him, but we can never really escape what he has done for us, because he has given us life. He has given us each blessing that we have. And I don't really know that us saying that we can leave him is even the right term, because if you look at Jonah, he tried to leave God and he tried to go as far as he could, but he couldn't leave. Rather, I would say it's a choice of not acknowledging him and choosing not to follow him. Because truly, whenever you become a Christian, it's not determining whether or not God will have an impact on your life. It's acknowledging that he does. And when you acknowledge that he does, it makes it so much easier for him to guide our paths. I hope that was really simple and easy to understand. But we're going to be talking about faith coming up. And faith is, okay, I'm going to tell you something really cool. So I kind of, at the start of this 100-day plan, God put a whole bunch of different topics and subjects on my heart, and what to talk about throughout this. And like, I did not have every single night plan in advance, but rather every single week, God, and I've had my heart open to it, but God has shown me and taught me on that specific subject for each week. And this week and this upcoming week, it is faith. And we'll be talking about the Great Depression, but for faith, it really does take faith and reliance on God. Or let me reset that. It takes a reliance on God to have faith. It takes a reliance on God for us to humble ourselves before him. And when we have that faith, when we have that faith and we go ahead and we gather what God has given to us, so that way he can use it, it may not seem like it's making any difference, but it's not the size of the fire, but rather the purpose. And the purpose is, if you're being obedient, if you're loving God with all of your heart, all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength, then you are obeying him. See, when we gather in faith, God is a spark that lights a revival, a much needed revival. He brings us back to life again. The civil war within our flesh and within our spirit is over, and he declares victory, so that way he can reconstruct our lives and our relationship with him. And that is nothing that we can do on our own. All right, so I finally found the passage. I think I've said I was gonna read it twice, but I felt like it really fit in with this tonight. John 6, the feeding of the 5,000. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes, and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these people may eat?" But this he said to test himself, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish, but what are they among so many?" Then Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Oh, okay, so real fast thought. You know how God created food? Can you just imagine how much good food and how good the food is that God could prepare? Like, you think the chefs here on earth are good. I bet you God has got some delicious meals up there if we eat in heaven. Or just eating here on earth, he could make a delicious meal. But then Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." You got Chef Jesus coming in the house. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, and number about 5,000. That goes exactly with what I was saying. So I had a little thought, because you know how whenever Jesus multiplied the wine at the wedding, the people there, they drank it and said, "Oh, this is the best wine ever." You know why? Because if God does it, it's not just good, it's the best. But now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples. And the disciples, those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, they gave as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost." Therefore, they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the sign of Jesus, and said, "This is truly the prophet who has come into this world." Now, I won't get on that right now. The main part I wanted to point out is how the little boy, the lad, the young lad, he brought to Jesus what he had, and Jesus used it to bless others. And are we bringing to Jesus what he has given to us? We can do all of these 7 ways to make the world a better place, but unless we bring to Jesus what he has given to us in faith, is there any purpose to it? Because anything that we try to do on our own will fail. Our kingdom will melt. It will fade. But anything that God does is eternal. It's permanent. And it brings good, truly good change. So, we truly and really do need to have reliance on God. And through that reliance, we need to have faith. And faith is an action. It's not just something you say, but it's something you also do. So, I want to encourage you. Go and be bold. Make the world a better place, but not on your own, because you can't make it a better place on your own. Go and make the world a better place with God's strength and His wisdom and His guidance. Everybody is advocating for change. I didn't say it was all good change, but everyone is advocating for change. If we want to see truly good change within our education, within our politics, within every single aspect of our lives, even within Hollywood, within YouTube, we need to look to God to give us the strength and the will and the guidance on what to do. It's actually reminding me of a Bible verse. Real fast, if you want to go and flip with me to James 2 while I search for it. But I also do want to just take a moment and say thank you so much for joining me tonight. I'm happy that we can gather together. But, yeah, you know, I love the Bible, but I don't know if it's just this Bible that I have or what, but I always have an interesting time getting open my pages whenever I think of something on the run. All right, James 2:14. You may know where I'm going with this. So, are you here? Excellent. Let's go ahead and let's start. What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, but one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warm and filled, but you do not give them things which are needed for the body, what does it profit it? Thus also faith by itself, it does not have works, it is dead. But if someone will say, you have faith, and I have works, show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that there is a God? You do. Well, even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? No. This is not saying that our good works are a way for us to get into heaven. Actually, this is saying that if we have faith in something, there will be an action behind it. Like preparing a fire. I go and I get some firewood, okay? I get this fire, and I have to gather it first before I can get a spark and light. And that spark, of course, is Jesus, as I talked about last night shortly. But once we get the wildfire, or not wildfire, but once we get the campfire and gather everything together and spark, then it will soon become a fire because we gathered in faith. I can sit back and I can say, yeah, dude, there'll be fire right here. But that doesn't, okay, like, okay, you believe it? Then prepare for it. We need to be preparing. Think about Elijah. This is another really cool story. Whenever he was going against the prophets of Baal, and they were seeing whose God would strike down fire first, Elijah, he prepared. But not in a way that you would think. He prepared by pouring water on the altar and drenching it in so much water He prepared it so that God's glory could be shown. And that is what happens when we humble ourselves. When we humble ourselves, it is preparing for God's glory to be shown. Because if God's glory is shown, it is true, it is permanent, and it is eternal. And it brings truly good change. The video you're about to be watching tomorrow night, I believe, if it's either tomorrow night or the next night, is going to be a video about that I'm really excited about us being ready and preparing for revival. It's not going to be a typical American campfire revival, but it'll be just as good. So I just want to tell you guys about that real fast. Tonight we're going to be praying for Burkina Faso, and the designation is hostile, which means it's not illegal, but it is very tense. So this is what it means to follow Christ and Burkina Faso. Large churches in the capital city operate openly, and until recently, even Christians living among Muslims in some villages had freedom to practice their faith. However, attacks against Christians increased dramatically in 2019. Today, few Christians remain in the north or east of the country. So we're going to be praying for the Christians there. That is really cool that they're able to legally have that faith to share, or that freedom to share their faith, which is an action. But we also have that in America. And, I'm ready for the next few nights. So make sure to stay tuned. But we're going to go ahead and we're going to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and thank you for allowing us to gather together, Lord. And I just want to pray for Burkina Faso. That's a cool name to say, Lord. Thank you for creating it. And I pray that this would be a time of revival, Lord, that we would gather and prepare what you have given us, and that we would be good stewards of it, and that we rely on you, Lord. And I pray that this would simply be something that we go and we do, not just something that we say, not just something that stays on our screens for 10 to 20 to 30 minutes a day, Lord, but Lord, this would be an action, Lord. Not to gain anything, but because of what you have given us. Lord, thank you for giving us life. Thank you for giving everyone around the world, including in Burkina Faso, life, Lord. Just all they have to do is simply choose to accept it. And I want to thank you for that opportunity to do that, so that way we can truly know you. I pray for everyone watching and the church and for the leaders that are going to step up, Lord, and Burkina Faso, and with me, in order to start this campfire revival, Lord. This American campfire revival. And I want to thank you so much for Kirk Cameron, Lord, and for giving him the strength and the courage to step up. And I want to pray for everyone that you would give them the strength and wisdom and the guidance on what to do, and that you would not allow pride to get in the way, but allow everyone, including me, to humble myself, Lord. Because I know that in order to truly humble myself, I need you. So Lord, thank you for this opportunity, and I pray that this would be a time where we go and we prepare. And in your holy name, amen. All right guys, thank you so much for watching American Campfire Revival Night 55. So we'll be going away from here and we will be getting even more lit. So I want to encourage you, stay tuned, because it's about to get lit. And you can stay tuned by subscribing, by sharing, and by clicking that like and notification bell. All right, I'll see you guys soon. Hasta luego.